Good morning and welcome to Crown of Life as we gather electronically this morning to worship our God. We are in the middle of a sermon series looking at God's gift of government, and today we're going to look and hold up his gift of prayer and hold it alongside his gift of government. Just a few announcements before we begin. Firstly, if you haven't done so already, please consider downloading the YouVersion Bible app. With it, you'll be able to access sermon notes, and you'll also have an electronic copy of the Bible to carry around with you as you're traveling. It's just a wonderful thing. Also, growth groups have begun. We would encourage you to attend a growth group. Our growth group series at this time is really slowing down and focusing deeply on the sermon lessons we're studying from week to week. So please reach out to the pastor at your campus to look at the times and places where we're gathering to study for our growth groups. Hope you can join us. Every member visits are just about to begin with your campus pastors. And so please take a moment to connect with them, to set up a time to meet. It's a wonderful time to just sit down and spend time getting to know each other a little bit more as we really just see what events are happening in life. So please do take the time to reach out to your pastor to set up a time to meet as well. We are also engaged with the Samaritan's Purse, and so we've been collecting toys for boys and girls, and we will be sending them not only out of state but out of country, and this is a way we partner with our community to provide gifts for those people who we might not even have the chance to meet. And in doing so, also, there are opportunities for the gospel to be proclaimed. So if you haven't taken a shoebox, please consider doing so. And we will return those all mid-November as well. The annual campout is coming up at Silent Valley from November 6th to 8th. If you're on the fence about attending, I'd encourage you to attend. Please reach out to one of the pastors who will send you the link to register for the camping trip. That's also just a wonderful time to slow down and spend some time in God's Word as we, applying social distancing guidelines, will be able to spend some time together as a family at Crown of Life. So please consider attending as well. With that, we will begin with our first song, God Bless Your Worship.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high.
Valley, yes, I will bless you.
Grace, mercy, and peace are yours in abundance from God our Heavenly Father, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our study of God's Word today, we're going to lift up God's gift of His gift of government and hold it alongside His gift of prayer. In order to do so, we're going to study a section of God's Word from 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we're going to read the first 8 verses together, and we're going to see that God encourages us to thank Him for His gift of government. Now, I'd encourage you to open up your electronic Bible or your hard copy and to read along as well. I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, and intercession and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed to the proper time, and for this purpose I was anointed, a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, and a true and faithful teacher of the Gentiles. Therefore, I want all men everywhere to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or disputing. This is the word of the Lord. From Riverside County to San Bernardino County, to our state, to our country, and across the world, now more than ever, it seems that people are polarized and angry. Polarized to the point of having a conviction or belief and not wanting to reach out and talk with someone who sees things differently. In fact, as we see the situation with anger and hatred heating up, it seems as though people being polarized and each having their own side where they defend their position, people seem to be unwilling to meet in the middle, to have even a discussion. And so we see the polarizing heat and hatred and anger exploding even onto our highways. Just a few weeks ago, two instances on our highways occurred where people ended up having a firefight. And so the polarization and the anger erupt. What's the connection between being polarized and God's gift of prayer? We're going to answer that today as we study God's word together. But as we begin, and as we think about those polarized feelings that can lead a person to have all these different emotions, whether it's being surprised or just angry to the point of being sick, or just angry or frustrated. As we look at this whole gamut of emotions, Let's begin by just asking a question this morning. How would you answer this? I am first and blank second. And these are the two options, prayerful and political. I am prayerful first and political second, meaning I go to God and ask for his help before engaging in looking at the way his gift of government is run. Or would you agree with the second statement saying, I am political and then prayerful? I get involved, I get angry, I get emotional, I'm polarized and stick in my corner, not wanting to reach out, and then I approach God in prayer. Which one of these two situations would you say most associates with you? In fact, if you were to ask a friend or a spouse or a loved one, and you were to ask them, well, which one of those two statements best described you, would that match the way you describe yourself? You see, having a polarized worldview and not wanting to see things from a different perspective can get in the way of prayer. It can get in the way of worshiping God. And that's a situation we find in 1 Timothy, where the Apostle Paul, writing to Pastor Timothy, who was overseeing a number of churches, was encountering intense polarization. Polarization within the Word and the Word of God, where people were going as far as saying, this is what I believe and I'm not going to even change, even if it goes contrary to what God says. And so Pastor Timothy was seeing a polarization take place in God's house as people fought with each other over serious things like God's word and even over things that weren't as serious. And so God wanted to speak to the congregations just as he wants to speak with you today. So let's jump in and just read the first two verses of 1 Timothy chapter 2. And here it is. It says, I urge you then, first of all, that petitions and prayers and intercession and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. What did God encourage his people to do? And here it is. God encouraged his people to pray for all people, including our leaders. And so God would encourage all of his people to begin with prayer and then to have the political conversation, if it's going to happen at all. And as God talks about his gift of prayer, he identifies four very important parts of prayer. So let's have a look at them. Firstly, God says he wants the requests, the prayers, to be made urgently. God wants you to speak to him about the things that keep you up at night, the things that make you feel a little anxious, those things that weigh heavily on your heart. And God doesn't stop there. He then says he wants you to have a continuous dialogue with him. So God speaks to you through his word, and you speak to God in prayer. And God wants to be involved in all parts of your life. Imagine like you only spoke to a loved one and they never responded back. That's not a conversation, that's an attempt to communicate. And so in the same way God says he wants us to communicate with him, where he speaks to us in his word and we speak to him in prayer. And how does God want us to do that? Well, he says he wants us to intercede. And so that's a word then that may make you think of a priest who would stand before the altar and pray for God's people. It may make you even think of your pastor who does that. But what God is talking about here is that you take something that is serious and urgent as you have a conversation, and God asks you to take those people in government and in leadership positions, and he wants you to hold them up before him as you pray for them. And how does God want you to pray? It's one of those words as well, with thanksgiving. See, thanksgiving is the one thing that binds this whole prayer together. To be able to go to God seriously and urgently and regularly with thanksgiving, praying for your leaders, is very much a God-pleasing prayer. And yet, who does God want you to pray for? The people or the party that you agree with? That person or party who shares your worldview? No. God says, I urge you to pray for all people, everyone. And this is a theme that comes up throughout the section of God's word. And so, friends, God encourages us to reach out and to pray for those people in our lives and to pray for our leaders. What do you think would happen to the polarization that exists if we prayed to God like this? If we thankfully prayed for our leaders, asking God to give them wisdom and strength and knowledge to lead wisely. As we thankfully approach God for all the people and leaders he's placed over us. Friends, if that's how we approached our God on a regular basis, the polarization that exists, wrapped not in thanksgiving, but in hatred and anger, that would melt away. And yet, what else does Jesus encourage us to do as we pray? See, in Matthew chapter 7, God talks to us about how even though we ask him, as we ask him for things, that it's important to know that he's going to answer us with our best interest in mind. He even makes a statement, if you, though you are evil, give good gifts to your children, how much more will I, God Almighty, give good gifts to you? In John chapter 15, we also learn a very important part of prayer, in that God encourages us then to approach him and to ask to pray according to his will. See, as Jesus knelt in the Garden of Gethsemane, asking his heavenly Father if there was a plan B in his plan of salvation, and receiving that answer of silence, Jesus ends by saying, well, not my will, but yours be done. Jesus, true God and true man, aligned his will with his heavenly Father perfectly, of course. And yet when we pray, we ask God to do the same thing, to take our will and to align it with his. And that's how Jesus can tell us then, whatever you ask in my name, with your will aligned with mine, it will be given. And yet, friends, why then, if we see the blessing of prayer, how it so quickly and consistently can melt away the polarization that surrounds us in our culture, why then do we still see so much polarization? Now, of course, you may be thinking that, well, the one word answer is sin. Yes, and it goes deeper than that. It's that sin-filled desire in each one of us to break free, to break free from the structure and the order that God has placed over us and around us for our protection, to break free from God's promises. And yet the dangerous thing when sin is involved is that it breaks down a relationship. It breaks down an individual. It breaks down peace and joy and leaves a person feeling empty and polarized and angry. And that's why in the section of God's word, he tells us, he says, just look and see how serious Jesus was about praying for and serving you. And Jesus encourages us to have that same that same seriousness and sense of urgency as we pray for those around us, including our leaders. And Jesus can make this request because he addresses you, his dear children, who have been brought to trust in him by the power of the Holy Spirit, who have been washed and cleansed in the waters of baptism, who now stand before the throne of God, free and forgiven. It's because your Savior lived and died for you that he can announce to you, your sins are forgiven. Now you are truly free. Free to serve me. And that's why Jesus encourages you to pray and to serve seriously. To pray and to serve urgently and to include your leaders in those prayers. And that really takes us then onto the next section we read, in which God reaches out and he tells us why he wants us to pray seriously and urgently. God tells us, this is good, and it pleases God, our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ, who gave himself as a ransom for sin. And so God encourages us. He says, pray that his will, that God's will be done. And there you see it. What is God's will? He only has one will. God wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. And that is why your God encourages you to pray. To pray that God grant wisdom and patience and understanding to our leaders, to pray that we will have opportunities to align our will alongside God, so that God might use us to proclaim his good news to those around us. And God wants us to proclaim this good news. He wants us to point to Jesus, because he wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. He doesn't want all people to save themselves. That's not what it says. And yet, so often, that's the false promise that government makes. If you just have the right person in the right place at the right time, then things will all work out. It'll be okay. No. God addresses the soul first. He wants all people to be saved. It's something God does as the Word of God is preached, and the Holy Spirit uses that to create and strengthen trust in our Savior. And that's why God encourages us to pray that we align our will with his, so that we might be used in as his instruments to proclaim his word. That's why it's so important to have leaders, so that with God's blessing and help, we might be able to live in a situation where we're able to proclaim the gospel. And that's one of the many wonderful freedoms we have in our country. And yet, as God talks about these wonderful blessings he gives to us, as he encourages us to continue to speak to him, so that through prayer, the polarization might be dissolved, like snow that's melted as the sun comes up on a warm day. God also gives us a warning. He says, therefore, I want men everywhere to be lifted up, praying with holy hands without anger or disputing. So the hands, the holy hands that God encourages us to lift up are holy because he's made them holy. As blood-bought, redeemed children of God, we stand before our God, forgiven and free and holy and cleansed. And now God encourages us to pray, saying, I want you to pray without anger or disputing. See, that's that anger and disputing, all those angry arguments, interfere with prayer. It leads to being polarized. In fact, when we look at anger, it's very much like drinking that poison and hoping it's going to hurt someone else. In fact, as we get angry, our blood pressure and our whole physiology just gets engaged, and what we can feel in our body also has an impact on our soul. And so our God says, lift up your hands and pray with thanksgiving and urgently, and holding up our leaders, having a conversation without anger or disputing. And so friends, as we are part of our culture and we see the things happening, when you feel anxious, when you feel disturbed, approach your God in prayer urgently and seriously. Pray for those leaders, that those people who are proposing that they want to be the next leader. Pray for your government. Pray for your state and your local government. Hold them up, giving thanks to God for the people He has placed over us. And friends, now, let's pray. What I'd like you to do right now is, it's on the screen. Follow this format. I'll begin, and then there'll be some moments of silence. I just want you to pray out loud if you're comfortable doing that. Let's pray. Merciful Father in heaven, thank you for your gift of government. Thank you for the security and the peace you provide through it, and our leaders. Please be with our president and our state and local governments. Give them wisdom to make decisions. And when they make decisions that we might not agree with, Lord, help us to continue to hold them up in prayer, giving thanks for the many gifts you've given us through them. Please, Lord, also give us a listening heart, a heart that first and foremostly listens to your voice in your word. And then, Lord, with listening hearts, keep our eyes focused on you and give us the strength to pray regularly to you. For, Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. And friends, the peace of God that far surpasses all understanding will guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Satisfies only you, Lord. You are my best thought by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, your presence my light. You are my wisdom, you are my
treasure. You are.